Overclockers, my name's Bryony, and as you've probably already guessed, this video is about AMD's brand new budget-friendly GPU, the RX 6500 XT. This long-awaited graphics card is the new entry-level 6000 series option, and it's been a long time coming as the RX 6600 XT launched all the way back in August. Compared to other launches, Overclockers UK has decent supply of this affordable option, and the competitive launch pricing is actually pretty unheard of in the current market. In this video, I'm going to focus on the Sapphire Pulse model, which I've got next to me here, and talk you through the specifications, design, and finally share those all-important performance benchmarks to see if this graphics card is up to scratch for gaming in 2022. The RX 6500 XT enters the market as an affordable graphics card with an MSRP of around £200. It's not being touted as the epic 1080p gaming card like the 6600 XT, but instead a budget-friendly way to step up your game, gain access to modern technology, and make recently released titles playable on an older PC. This GPU uses the new RDNA 2 architecture and features 16 compute units and ray tracing accelerators, a 16 MB Infinity cache, 4 GB of GDDR6 memory, and the fastest gaming card clock speed of 2600 MHz. With hardware like that, this graphics card has support for ray tracing, Fidelity FX, DirectX 12 Ultimate and VRS, and the 4 GB of VRAM makes it much less appealing to those pesky Ethereum miners. Additionally, the 6500 XT is incredibly efficient, and it's rated at just 107 watts, which is around 20% more efficient than the 5500 XT. This means that it can be used with as little as a 400-watt PSU, which is going to be much more affordable, and it only requires a single 6-pin connector, which ensures greater compatibility. One thing I will mention though is that unfortunately the 6500 XT isn't all sunshine and rainbows, and there is a couple of things in the specification list you should consider if you're thinking of purchasing this graphics card. The 6500 XT has PCIe 4x4 connectivity as opposed to the x8 or x16 we're used to seeing on these modern cards. This is a cost-saving measure that makes sense when the card is used with a PCIe 4 compatible motherboard, as there's easily going to be enough bandwidth. However, when installed in a PCIe 3 slot, VRAM intensive gaming performance can be negatively affected. As seen with our benchmarking results, and being a budget card, it's more likely to end up in a slightly older PC with PCIe Gen 3. Additionally, the 6500 XT doesn't support AV1 decoding and H.265 HEVC encoding, which is something that the other graphics card in the 6000 series stack will feature. This is likely to impact your ability to record and stream content using this GPU, and it's going to be a setback for budget systems with a slower CPU that could actually struggle with the demanding video formats. Just like the AMD Radeon 6600 XT launch, the RX 6500 XT is being handled by AMD's add-in board partners. At the moment, the models from these manufacturers are quite limited at launch. However, Sapphire, who exclusively manufacture AMD Radeon cards, have provided Overclockers UK with a reasonably good supply of the Sapphire Pulse, which is the card that I'm going to be focusing on in this video. It uses the tried and tested Sapphire Pulse cooler, which was used on the 6600 XT. However, it's actually been reduced in size, and it's slightly shorter by around 4.5 centimeters, and it has a total length of 194 millimeters. This is going to make it more easily compatible with smaller micro ATX builds, where the larger GPUs might not fit. Taking a look at the design of the cooler, it's the ideal choice for a budget graphics card. It's aesthetically pleasing, it has this subtle black and red design that doesn't really waste money on fancy RGB lighting or gimmicks. The cooling is powered by these two large fans, and they use hybrid fan blades and intelligent fan control, which is going to ensure better airflow, heatsink coverage, and supposedly a lower noise compared to a standard cooling design. And I must admit, while I was using this card, it was very quiet during testing, and I think it's a great balance between performance and noise. As with most modern graphics cards, the fans will also completely turn off for silent operation when you're using it for those lighter workloads. On the back of the card, the all aluminium backplate completes the design, increases heat dissipation, keeps dust out, and provides a little bit of additional rigidity, which means the cooler is going to be better supported. Finally, at the rear of the 6500 XT, you'll find connectivity for a maximum of two monitors with one DisplayPort and one HDMI port. The day one launch pricing of just £229 means these cards are decent value for money in the current market, and personally, I think that Sapphire have priced them fairly. Plus, as you'll see after my benchmark results, they're going to be the ideal choice for gaming at 1080p, even in the latest games. However, if previous releases are anything to go by, expect prices to potentially creep up after the initial launch. Moving on to the performance testing, and in my test system I paired the Sapphire Hulse with a Ryzen 5 3600 processor and 16GB of 3600MHz memory. With the Ryzen 5000 series now available, the 3600 maybe seems like a little bit of a strange choice, but I used it in my 6600 XT testing and it made sense that in a real world scenario a more affordable CPU would be paired with a budget graphics card. Therefore, it's easier for anyone who's looking at this card to get more of an idea of how this GPU might perform in their own PC, and even compare it to my 6600 XT results if you're stuck between the two. When it comes to the exact memory and GPU clock speeds for the Sapphire Pulse out of the box, they hadn't actually been released yet at the time of filming our video. However, during testing, here's what I saw my sample reach. The Sapphire Pulse clock frequency boosted as high as 2845MHz, but on average it would hover around 2800. This is actually much higher than AMD's expected game frequency of 2610MHz, and similar to the maximum boost frequency expected during short bursty workloads of up to 2815. This is likely to vary on each individual GPU, it's all down to the silicon lottery, but it shows that this Sapphire Pulse is boosting nice and high and it's going to provide greater performance thanks to a higher clock speed. Additionally, to squeeze further performance out of this GPU, there is the Sapphire Trix software. It allows you to tune the card's performance with Trix Boost and even save custom settings for your favourite games. It's designed to be simple to use and it makes it nice and easy to monitor the 6500 XT's vital signs. Speaking of vital signs, when it came to testing the performance of the cooler, I ran Unigen Heaven for 30 minutes and recorded the results. It was installed in a Fantix P600S case and it idled at a rather cool 30 degrees and maxed out at 63 degrees under heavy load with a hotspot of 82. Overall, I think this Sapphire actually did a pretty good job with the cooler and the overall design of the Sapphire Pulse. Moving on to the next part of the video, which is also the most exciting, and that's all about real-world gaming performance. I tried out a total of 8 different games, and I selected these games based on them being newly released, with modern graphics, also what's most popular on Steam, and a few of the less demanding esports titles, which are more suited to a more affordable graphics card. All of these games were set to medium or high graphical settings, and in Far Cry 6, Fidelity FX Super Resolution was available, so I did turn it on to the ultra quality setting to get that extra performance boost. In all of the games, I did my testing with the resolution set to 1080p. This is because the RX 6500 XT does only have that 4GB of VRAM, which means it's not really suited to pairing with a 1440p monitor. Instead, I would suggest checking out the 6600 XT instead, which I found during my testing could actually handle the higher resolution really well. You can spot the video here. Additionally, we tested each of the games with the motherboard PCIe slot locked to both PCIe 4 and 3, with smart access memory enabled and disabled, to see how this was going to impact performance and give you more of an idea of how this GPU might perform when installed in your particular system. Even though I use a Ryzen 5 3600X, this should help mimic the FPS percentage gains and losses that can be expected with a Ryzen or Intel processor on newer and older platforms. For example, you will need a Ryzen 3000, 5000, or Intel 10th or 11th gen to enable resizable bar. Being a more budget GPU, it's likely that it's actually going to end up in a system with older CPUs that are still perfectly fine for playing a lot of games. However, this is not really the ideal situation, as the FPS can be negatively affected without smart access memory. Or, like I mentioned at the start of the video, the restricted PCIe Gen 3 bandwidth. This can be seen quite clearly in my gaming benchmark results, but even in an older system, you might be pleasantly surprised at how this graphics card performs. First up is the four esports games. We split the graphs into four different hardware scenarios, so make sure to pause on the one that's most relevant to you, or check the description below for timestamps. As you can see from my results, the less demanding games such as CSGO, League of Legends, Apex Legends and PUBG run brilliantly on the 6500 XT, even in a less than ideal scenario. You can still expect to get over 100 FPS, and in some cases you even get over 200 FPS, and that's on high or max graphical settings. If you're only interested in playing esports titles, it might actually be worth pairing the 6500 XT with a 1080p gaming monitor with 144Hz or even 240Hz refresh rate. The next series of graphs are made up of the more demanding titles we tested, and once again, make sure to pause and check out the graph that's more relevant to your hardware. The results for this more budget card are actually really impressive, and Forza Horizon 5, Dirt 5, Red Dead Redemption 2 and Far Cry 6 all ran reasonably well. You can see that once again, even without access to a Gen 4 slot and smart access memory, the 6500 XT is capable of playing these latest games. Even with medium to high graphical settings, you're getting an average of at least 60 FPS. And of course, this could be improved further if you're willing to play around with the graphical settings and tweak it to improve the FPS and ensure that that minimum FPS doesn't dip too low. The wrong presets can really cause a big drop in performance if you push it past the available 4GB of VRAM. Finally, just to really demonstrate what I said earlier, we combined the results and compared the difference between turning off smart access memory and having it turned on. Unsurprisingly, I found that there was a noticeable drop in FPS across the majority of the games we tested. The amount did vary from title to title, and some of the results I have actually did require a double check, as there was such a large difference, or actually no difference at all. But trust me, they are right, I'm pretty sure. However, it's safe to say having a motherboard and CPU with resizable bar technology will massively help your FPS with the 6500 XT. The same thing can be said when comparing the percentage difference in FPS between installing the 6500 XT in a PCIe Gen 3 slot and PCIe Gen 4 slot. With smart access memory off, the difference was actually more pronounced. But even with smart access memory enabled, there was actually still a couple of games that had a noticeable drop in FPS due to the restricted bandwidth. However, there is also a couple of games that appear to be barely unaffected at all. I think one thing to take away from this, however, is that even despite the loss of FPS, when paired with a less than ideal kind of hardware scenario, the 6500 XT still plays games admirably at 1080p, even on high and medium graphical settings. Finally, for those of you that absolutely love those benchmark results, here is the scores achieved by the 6500 XT in the popular benchmarking tool 3DMark, with all the different PCIe and smart access memory configurations. Pause now so you can take a closer look at our results. Well, that was certainly a long one, but I hope that you found all of those benchmark results nice and useful, and thank you for watching the Overclockers UK launch and testing video on the AMD Radeon 6500 XT Sapphire Pulse. The GPU market has been all over the place the past couple of years, but hopefully this card helps to satisfy the huge demand for a more affordable GPU. It's a good looking, power efficient card, and you should be able to achieve some really good gaming performance in your own system, the Sapphire Pulse 6500 XT. I recommend pairing this GPU with a 1080p monitor and really playing around with a few of the settings in those newer games to really get the most out of this card and maximize its performance. Even though performance is negatively affected when it's installed in a Gen 3 slot or without the all-important smart access memory, it's not actually enough to cripple the card, and it should still provide a decent upgrade for an older PC that's really struggling to play the latest titles. If you like the look of the 6500 XT, remember to check out the full range on the Overclockers website, which will all be ready to order from the 19th of January. And hopefully there will still be a good supply of cards available if you're watching this video at a later date. Remember to give this video a big thumbs up, hit the subscribe button, and also leave us a comment below letting me know what you think of this brand new graphics card from AMD.